Testing, testing, one, two.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. Is everybody hearing me well? Wonderful. It falls to me this evening to welcome everyone to an activity of the Institute of Caribbean Studies within the Faculty of Humanities and Education right here on the UWI Mona campus. And I always say that this is certainly the coolest department on campus, and that does not diminish our rigor. I'd like to this evening greet very specially our very special guests and individuals who have been working really hard behind the scene to bring us all here together for this, the 27th annual Bob Marley lecture. And I would like to begin with acknowledging Dr. Marvin Reed, who is representing the deputy principal this evening. Dr. Dave Goss, our own head of department in the Institute of Caribbean Studies, conference chair, Dr. Sonia Stanley Nair. We're expecting a number of visitors from the diplomatic corps. Unfortunately, they're not here yet, but we look forward to having them join us a little later. There are a number of very distinguished faces and a number of faces that have come from far and wide, and I don't want to get into any trouble this evening, so I'd like to welcome everybody, all our distinguished guests who are here with us this evening for this lecture. So it falls to me, we don't draw lots, but we do a rotation system here at the Institute of Caribbean Studies. And for all of the activities we have, we take turns in having the privilege of hosting you all here this evening, and tonight is my turn. And I thought a little bit about this gathering this evening, and I thought a lot about this notion of the 27th annual Bob Marley lecture. And this year, it has taken on a life of its own. This year, it has taken on a spiritual dimension. It has taken on an acknowledgement of his financial dimension. It's become a very emotional time. And it's an existential moment. I think everybody can agree that with the convergence of the film all across the world and the music and the excitement and the conference itself that has been going on this week, that it has brought the enormity of spirit that Bob Marley is into this room. And it would also be remiss of me if I did not acknowledge Professor Carolyn Cooper, whose brainchild, whose extensive work has brought us all together to be able to celebrate this, this 27th lecture. But in particular, this evening, I want to say a welcome to Sister Empress Barbara Blake Hannah, who is going to be leading us through her story of a friendship with this enormous figure, iconic figure in Jamaican life. And as I thought about you, Sister Barbara, the word that stuck in my mind was inclusion. And with inclusion, of course, there's a dialectic of exclusion. And I thought about you because I think inclusion is one of those words that has characterized your life. It's been a lifetime of gatekeepers, a lifetime of officers of exclusion. Many of those who cast aspersions and judgment and have had the temerity to try to close doors and to pretend in their places of power. And that you are here to tell the tale is a wonderful thing. And I want to ask you to put your hands together for our lecturer this evening. We're going to move through very quickly this evening, and I am going to first ask to do the official welcome on behalf of our department, our head of department, Dr. Dave Goss.
One love, brothers and sisters, one love. It is my privilege this evening to welcome you all to this very distinguished 27th annual Bob Marley lecture. I want to welcome our face-to-face audience and also our online audience. This lecture is an annual event held by the ICS and the Reggae Studies Unit. And I want to stress that this is our 27th staging. And I'm saying that deliberately to differentiate the ICS from those others caught in the current euphoria surrounding Bob Marley and the movie One Love. While we, as Jamaicans, we are thrilled that numerous media entities across the world are hunting down reggae scholars to hear more about Bob Marley, we at the ICS have been theorizing on Bob Marley for the last 27 years as an imperative. As further evidence of our commitment to Bob Marley, from our over 60 odd courses we teach annually, Bob Marley and his music is one of our more popular undergraduate courses. Hundreds of UE students across our 7 faculties over the last several years have taken that course yearly as an elective. We have been reintroducing Bob Marley and his music academically to our UE students. And we're not surprised that popular culture now views Bob Marley as a national hero. But as scholars, we cannot separate Bob Marley from his Rastafari faith. We in the SAS have been teaching for the last decade courses on Rastafari. Courses such as Rastafari in the global context, the culture of Rastafari, Rastafari women, patriarchy and gender justice, Rastafari ital liberty and socioeconomic justice. We not only have courses on Rastafari, but one of our six minors in the ICS is also on Rastafari studies. Additionally, we recognize the connection between Rastafari, reggae, and the sound systems. The sound systems which are homegrown were significant in the spread of reggae and its derivative genres. Two of our more recent courses are sound systems, its impact on sonic technology, and material resonance, musical instruments, and sonic cultures of the Black Atlantic. So it's not coincidental that we are academically still studying the impact of the sound systems. It's not coincidental either that our appreciation of Bob Marley this evening is located in the very middle of our current staging of the 8th Global Reggae Conference under the title A Century of Sound, Technology, Culture, and Performance. So we at the ICS are pleased that we are contributing academically to the study of our Caribbean culture, whether it's about Bob Marley, Alexander Bedward, or Miss Lou. Culture for us is much more than singing and dancing. It is our lifeblood, our DNA, and our passport. So as we celebrate Bob Marley this evening, we are thrilled to have, as our guest speaker, an outstanding Jamaican woman who is herself a legend and a friend of Bob. I speak of no other than Miss Barbara Blake Hanna, CD. She'll be introduced shortly, but I must say how grateful we are for her acceptance to deliver this lecture. My first impression of her when I glanced at her CV, I said to myself, how could she accomplish so much in one lifetime? And she's still young. I was struck last summer. I was in the British Library combing through this part of paper called the West Indian newspaper. This is the second oldest West Indian newspaper in the UK. Started in 1971, but the earlier one in 1958 by the West Indian Gazette. Then an editorial caught my eye. The outgoing editor emphasized that they now brought on board a new editor of the paper. And that new editor was our guest speaker. Well, he's our guest speaker, Miss Barbara Blake Hanna. And the outgoing editor was so confident in the young Barbara Blake Hanna to turn the fortune of the paper around and to carry to new horizons. I mentioned this to make the point that our guest speaker had a distinguished record of excellence, and we are proud to have her deliver this annual lecture. But how could we have a Bob Marley lecture without members of the extended Marley family? We want to thank you, Stephanie, right? We want to thank you, Stephanie, for gracing us with your presence as part of the Marley family. And we want to thank you, and we know that the family, we have kept Bob Marley's legacy and mission alive and will be alive for many more years with the amount of music you guys are actually producing. We're also privileged to have some of our members of staff here this afternoon, and I want to single out Professor, the one and only Vereen Shepherd. Prof, thank you for coming, and we are really delighted to have you. Other members of staff in our department and also in our faculty. I see my fellow lecturer there in philosophy and other lecturers here, both online and in the audience. I want to welcome you. In closing then, I want to just remind you to subscribe to our YouTube page and to join us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. May Marley's spirituality continue to guide us and inspire us as we continue to work towards one love, one aim, and one destiny. Thank you very much.
Those of you who have a program will see that we had expected to have join us the Honorable Olivia Grange, Minister of Culture, Gender, Entertainment, and Sport. But I'm sure, as you will, those of you who are keeping up with Jamaican life will recognize that this is a very busy time in the lives of the political, and I am sure Ms. Grange is doing the very best that she can under the circumstances to come and join us. We're hoping she will join us, the minister will join us before the end of the evening. But we do have with us this evening Stephanie Marley, a member of the Marley family, who is the managing director of the Bob and Rita Marley Foundation, who we're very pleased to invite to come and greet us this evening. Ms. Marley.
Greetings and salutation, everyone. All blessed protocols observed. Honor and respect to everyone for taking the time out to be here and just for still loving and being interested in the little boy from 9 Mile who became an international reggae superstar. It is my pleasure to be here to bring greetings on behalf of my family and also on behalf of the Faculty of Humanities and Education, which I do believe is a critical and instrumental area of study and practice in this here and now era, but in all the eras of our story. And I'm here feeling that this whole world is in a new era, that something has shifted in this world. You said it's spiritual, and I certainly feel it is. And I think it's something that we should capture while it's happening. I do believe that there's a window of opportunity for personal growth, spiritual growth, growth in our families, in our communities, and definitely for national development. I believe it and I feel it. I wonder if anybody else feeling it. Yes. This here is a time that I think we all have to make sure that we are mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually aware, alert, and awake, and also active. I think it's an important time for us to activate ourselves as humans, to become humanitarians, and as individuals to pursue knowledge, pursue freedom. I would say that, truth be told, when my parents started singing, it was never about money or fame or any inclination of becoming heroes. But they sang to liberate themselves. They sang because they had a cry and a yearning for freedom. And it wasn't just for themselves, but they wanted liberation for the whole world. And I wonder how many of us can say that we are actively contributing to the welfare of the human race. And that's what I think music is doing, but I also think that contributing to the welfare of the human race can happen in different dynamics, whether it's through art, spirituality. I just believe that there's room for everybody in here to be their better selves, to be more developed, to contribute to their society, their community. And as I speak about this new era, it's important that we're, as Jamaicans would say, tan toddy. And for those who don't know what it means stand sturdy, stand firm, because no weak heart is going to prosper in this new era. So, you know, just have to talk about my mother and my father a little bit. They are my role models, and mom to me, I've always seen her as the lion and the lamb, very loving and compassionate, but yet avid, very, very, very much a protector and a defender. Dad, a true Buffalo soldier and a prophet, who, again, I think fulfilled his contribution or his dedication to our national pledge to contribute to the welfare of the human race. Neither of them were perfect. You know, none of us are. But they were both very determined, not just to do this, the best for themselves, but for others. So as I stand here, I cry for liberation. I yearn for it. And I think this era, in this time now, we should be all seeking for liberation, mental, physical, emotional, and spiritual liberation. And I question you to think about your own contribution to the welfare of the human race. And it begins with your self-development, development within your families, in your community. And I think it's important that we all commit to the contribution of national development. So the Rita Mali Foundation has spearheaded a public education and empowerment campaign called Wake Up Jamaica. And the mission is to really bring our people home and abroad to the awareness and to the realization that each individual has a role and a responsibility to play in the development of our nation. So, yeah, as he was plugging, I'm gonna plug too. Please follow Wake Up Jamaica at WakeUpJA876 on Instagram. And our website is wakeupja.com. And it is my honor to be here, knowing that Sister Barbara is going to do a lecture today, this evening, speaking on her friend Bob Marley. Do enjoy.
Right. Dr. Goss just reminded me that I didn't tell you who I am. My name is Deborah Hickling Gordon, and now you know. To the members of the, to those individuals who have come from far and wide to be with us at this time, I want to say a very, very special welcome to you. Can I ask those people who have traveled from other parts of the world to come and share with us your information and share in the information coming out of the Institute, please to stand. Please, can you just stand so that we can see you? Jet lagged, yay or nay, as we welcome you specially. Sir Copeland, you don't count today. Oh. Welcome back. Well, all right, so you do count today. Welcome, everybody, including Sir Copeland. Also want to say welcome to the students. Can we see the students of the Institute of Caribbean Studies, please? Can you all stand? Make yourselves known, put up your hand, come, let's see you. Some will require jobs eventually. Some will require having counsel with you. So when you see them and they say they come from ICS, I ask you to please indulge them, as they are the individuals who are going to be taking the scholarship further. We move on now to invite Mr. Nathan Laldi, who is a student in the Bachelor of Arts in Music and Performance Studies, which is one of the three bachelor's programs that we offer here at the Institute of Caribbean Studies. This gives me an opportunity to say that we offer three bachelor's programs, the flagship program, the Entertainment and Cultural Enterprise Management program, led by Dr. Dennis Howard. You can stand up too, Sir Dennis. Wave at the people who don't, well, the one person who doesn't know you in here. the Institute, the Cultural and Creative Industries, the Bachelor of Cultural and Creative Industries, which I'm pleased to lead, and of course the Music and Performance Studies Bachelor of Arts, which is led by Dr. Ray Hitchens, who I'm not seeing at the moment, but these are three important programs that are contributing to the cultural landscape that is that exists within Jamaica and the Caribbean, and indeed the world. So, you ready for us? Not quite? In television, Miss Barbara, they would say stretch. Stretch? No? So yes, I'm getting stretch. All right. Some of the thoughts that I had while I was working through the process of coming through, coming. Yeah. Except maybe for the video. I don't know. For the video. So you come put it back, but except maybe for the video. All right. So you ready? We ready? We're ready. Yeah, it's our ready time. All right. Ready, steady, go. Nathan Laldi of, half ready? Okay. All right, so. All right. Here we go. Play on. Thank you. Thank you so much, Laldi. That was wonderful. Now, one of those three little birds told me that the minister is en route. And so we will hear from her. We're going to do as we do in Jamaica. We're just going to take things one moment at a time. Yeah? We're going to... No, we're moving ahead. And when she comes, she will be able to greet us as is appropriate. And I'm going to invite at this time Dr. Dennis Howard, lecturer in the Institute of Caribbean Studies, and as I had said earlier, the leader and coordinator of the Bachelor of Arts in Entertainment, Cultural Enterprise Management, and to come and introduce our lecturer this evening.
Greetings, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce our guest lecturer. But listen, let me tell you something. If I were to go into all of the details about this great lady's achievement, we'll be here until tomorrow. So I will attempt to cover all the bases, and you'll tell me, Barbara, if I've covered them adequately, because, you know, it's a very daunting task. So Barbara Blake-Hannah, a name synonymous with Jamaican culture and activism, wears many hats: author, filmmaker, journalist, cultural consultant, and much, much more. Born in Kingston, I was about to say the age, but I will not say it. Her journey began with early exposure to media through her father, the great man, father's news magazine. This ignited a passion that led her to London, where she honed her public relations and journalism skills. In 1968, Blake-Hannah made history as Britain's first black TV journalist, paving the way for others. Though faced with racism, she persevered, writing for renowned publications like the Sunday Times and Queen's Magazine. On returning to Jamaica in 1972, she continued her media work while advocating for Rastafari culture and reparations for slavery. She served as an independent senator, campaigned for marijuana legislation, and established the Jamaica Reparations Movement. She also contributed to the film industry when she organized the Jamaica Film Festival, the first film festival in Jamaica, as I understand it, and the Reggae Film Festival, while directing documentaries like Race Rhetoric Rastafari and a children's film called Kids Paradise. Her tireless efforts have been recognized with numerous awards, too numerous to mention, including the prestigious Order of Distinction CD from the Jamaican government. Today, she remains an active cultural consultant and board member for the Cannabis Licensing Authority, quite appropriately. Barbara Blake-Hannah's life is a testament to resilience, cultural pride, and a commitment to social justice. Her pioneering spirit inspires generations and paved the way for a more inclusive and equitable world. Ladies and gentlemen, to present the prestigious Bob Marley Lecture for 2024, Barbara Blake-Hannah.
What?
Can we put it right on the front here? Yes. McConan, can you help me put it right on the front?
Yes. Thank you. You need a thumb tack?
I have one.
You got it?
No, I have one.
Kiddos, Lord, who am Lach. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bless us all who are gathered here, Holy Father, and those who are listening and watching online. Bless me also, thy humble daughter, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in thy sight, O Jah, Rastafari. It's a real pleasure to be here, giving the 27th Bob Marley lecture. I'd like to thank so many people. Professor Goff, thank you so much for being kind enough to invite me to deliver this lecture. I have to thank Professor Carolyn Cooper, the founder of the Reggae, Rastafari Reggae Studies Unit, the Reggae Studies Unit. So many years ago, so much good work has been done to recognize and give recognition to Rastafari, not just reggae. Professor Vereen Shepherd, a very special lady in my life. She invited me long ago when she was a professor of history here to come and give a lecture to her students on reparations. And I said, I named my prize. My prize was that she would help me host a conference on reparations here at the university. And she gave me this lecture hall. We held the first conference of the Jamaica reparations movement. There were 30 people here, and they all signed on to our reparations document, 30 of us, people including two members of parliament, one of whom later took the reparations issue to parliament in a debate. The Jamaica reparations movement became the foundation of the National Reparations Conference under the hands of a lady named Olivia Grange, who was then the minister. I have such a wonderful array of friends. I'm such an independent. Here I am sitting with the PNP spokesperson on culture, my little girlfriend, Deborah Hickling, whose father I know so well. Yeah, my little girlfriend. She's one of my daughters. And Professor Shepherd, who is now head of the Center for Caribbean Reparations. Thank you. And then Babsy Grange, my girlfriend, she happens to be the minister. You know, she just said, well, Barbara, I didn't give you the day off from work, you know, but I know I'm going to be on the road. I'm going to try and put my head in. And I know she's the minister, and if she comes, she's, you know, official and to make an official statement, but she probably just wants to hear what I have to say to make sure I don't make any mistakes. So here I am, ready to give the Bob Marley lecture, my friend Bob Marley. Some special guests here. There's a very special guest, gentleman sitting in the front row, Angelo Carrera. He flew here day before yesterday, and he flew here, his own plane, just to be here at this lecture. He brought a plane load of friends with him. Some of them are here in the audience, yes. He has a special reason for being here, for wanting to be here, and I'm so glad. Thank you, Angelo, for being here. My girlfriend, I see Sister Aisha in the audience. Other Rastafari sisters, oh, Queen, Empress of Zion. Where is she? Empress of Zion, thank you so much. Stephen Golding, Mr. Reparations himself, the UNIA. Is that you over there, sir? Copeland Forbes, good heavens. Thank you for being here. Names, yeah. At my age, names run away with you just when you walk them, but you know who. Thank you very much, thank you, Maconan. Errol Bean, a very special friend. You know, you have those friends on Facebook that every time you write, they come up and say something great that makes you feel so great. See him there, his name is Errol Bean. Put up your hand and make them see you. I love him so much, yes. Just friends. Sister Maxine Stowe is here as well, a lady I know well from Rastafari circles, and also knowing of her reggae history. So here we all are. Professor Sonia Stanley Nair, always doing an excellent job on reggae. One of the icons of this reggae studies unit. I could go on with the congratulations and the recognitions for a long time, but let me start my lecture. We are well underway. Legends aren't born, they are made by their deeds. Marley's in the house. Let me just greet Sister Stephanie Marley and all the Marleys who may be watching online, all the friends of Bob Marley who will be watching online to hear what I have to say. I became Bob Marley's friend in a very interesting way. I was working in Britain. That time, by then I'd gone to the BBC. I wasn't working in front of camera. I was in production now and had given the program I worked on the idea of doing a film on the Cannes Film Festival. We'd done it. We came back from Cannes. I was at the point where I really was tired of the racism in Britain, and some of which had been exposed, you know, on this production. I was sitting at my desk. I told them, don't even put my name in the credits. I got a phone call from Chris Blackwell. I knew him from Jamaica from before I left. He said, hey, Barbara, Perry Hensler's made a movie, our first Jamaican movie. We hear you were at Cannes. We'd love you to help us take it to some film festivals and do some PR. I said, sure, let me see it. I went to see this film, and it blew my mind. I'd never seen anything like it. I knew a little about reggae. You know, a little. I remember when my secretary came to me and asked me to translate 007 Shantytown, Dema Loot, Dema Shoot, Dema. She said, I thought you said you were Jamaican. But I never knew anything about Rasta. And when the Rasta man came out of the water and threw his locks up as Jimmy Cliff was singing, sitting here in limbo, wondering where to go. That hit me right in the solar plexus, and I knew I had to come back to Jamaica and find out what Rasta was. Chris Blackwell said to me, Barbara, come back and work for me. I said, no, thank you. I want to go back to Jamaica and become a Rasta. He said, yeah, you gotta laugh. He said, well, do me one little favor. I've just signed a new group, and I've brought some journalists down to Jamaica. Will you show them around for me? Go up to 56 Hope Road. The guys are around the back. I went and I was introduced by a girl I knew from London who was then with Bob. And this is the group. How do you do, sir? Mr. Bob Marley. And I showed the journalists around and I left and went off to continue doing my learning about Rasta. My teacher was Dougie Mack up at Warwicka Hill. And the mystic revelation of Rastafari, Sam Clayton, Fillmore Alvarenga. That was my school, and I was studying. I would go up there every week to keep a youth club on Warwicka Hill, and that was my life, that was my life. I also had a good girlfriend, a black American movie star named Vonetta McGee, who I'd met when we were in London. She called me one day and said, Barbara, what are you doing in Jamaica? Come, I've just bought a house, come help me set it up. We've just bought a house. Her manager starred as the Mac, one of the biggest black Hollywood movie stars, and black Hollywood was everything at that time. All the movies, Shaft, you know, Blackula, all the films. So I went up to LA, you know, help her fix up her house. They'd bought a huge house in the Hollywood Hills. They'd made it. And while we're there and all black Hollywood is happening, and I'm meeting all these movie stars and singing stars, Stevie Wonder, Billy Paul, I said, hey, you know, I just come from the Cannes Film Festival. Why don't we do a film festival in Jamaica? And she said, hey, good idea, a black film festival. You think you can do it? I said, sure, man. She said, okay, I'll get the films. She rang up all the producers and got the films and got the stars. And I called up my girlfriend who I'd lived with in London. We went to London together. She'd come back to Jamaica. Her name was Beverly Anderson. By then, she'd married the man named Michael Manley and become the first lady. I know all these famous people. And I called up Beverly and said, hey, will you and your husband be patrons of if I bring some black films down? They said, oh, yes. So there began the road to the first Jamaica Film Festival, 1974. The Jamaica Tourist Board was not pleased at this black film festival, they called it. They wouldn't call it the Jamaica Film Festival. They were not pleased because they were at that time only pitching to white tourism, very wealthy white tourists, Roundhill. So, you know, we were the revolutionaries. I drove around Jamaica, I had two friends helping me, and there was this song that was very popular, and it was, if you are the big tree, we are the small axe. red sharpened to cut you down, ready to cut you down. And that was us. We drove around Jamaica singing that. And it was by what? Those guys that Chris asked me to, some of the journalists, oh, how nice. So when time came for the final, the film festival was hugely successful. Brought a whole heap of black movie stars here, Jim Brown, Paula Kelly, Rosalind Cash. We showed Autobiography of Miss Jane Pittman. We showed a lot of great movies, Six Nights. And then now for the final awards night, we said, hey, let's go and ask Bob Marley and the Wailers if they'll play at the awards show. I went up to 56 Hope Road, and he was very nice. He said, sure, we'll play. But when it came time to discuss the money, we couldn't afford it. So they didn't play on our final night. But that was another step to our friendship. And when the film festival finished, Michael Manley gave me a job in the office of the Prime Minister, which was really nice. And so on my way home, I lived in New Kingston, I would stop at 56 Hope Road, and visiting Bob became part of my education as a Rasta. Bob Marley took Rasta uptown, literally. 56 Hope Road became the oasis for the Rastafari community. It was a place where we could stop and rest, where we could meet and reason with so many people. I mean, there were friends that I met there, Skill Cole, oh gosh, I wrote down some names. Do I remember them all? Seiko, can't forget Seiko. Paul Kelly, who looked after the office around the back. Neville Garrick, of course. So there I was growing as a Rasta, and my friendship with Bob was an important part of my growing as a Rasta. I remember one evening as I stopped on the way from the office of the Prime Minister, you know, I would stop there and get a little spiff and literally learn how to be a Rasta woman. You know, a Rasta woman don't go and mix up with the guys kind of thing, you know. You keep yourself politely and modestly to the side, and you make sure you're properly dressed in a skirt, no trousers, and your head covered. And we were sitting there, and Bob just picked up his guitar. Dermot Hussey, who ran a really important radio program then, Dermot was there, and Bob said, Dermot, see some new songs I'm working on? And he just started to play song after song, music after music, some complete, some snatches, like water flowing from a river. When we all just marveled, Bob just smiled and shrugged off the praise and said, not I, but the Most High in I. I always remember that word, those words. I use them all the time. Not I, but the Most High in I. I don't know which songs there were, if any of them ever became songs we know. It was just a very special moment as the dusk shadows dropped on a beautiful Rasta evening. I was glad to have been there, privileged. In March 1975, the Jackson Five came to Jamaica to do a concert. And there was a lot of controversy about the fee that Bob Marley and the Wailers had asked in order to play. They'd been invited to perform with Jackson Five. And they were saying, show them no worth it, and who are they? They're just some Rastas. And I wrote an article, it came out in the Star, and I said, no, they deserve their pay, because their popularity reminded me of the popularity of the Beatles when they were becoming famous, and please pay them their money. And lo and behold, yes, so the Wailers were paid their money, and because of the article, I was entitled to, you know, be around front stage, around the stage. And there I was, right literally under the stage of that Bob Marley concert. That was really nice. Balfour Henry wrote about it. Poor seating organization and technical audio problems resulted in the show starting almost 2 hours after the scheduled start time. Yeah, that meant that the Jackson Five had to perform first because in the contract, Michael Jackson wasn't allowed to perform after midnight. So the Jackson Five went on first, and then the Wailers took over. Here, Balfour Henry. The show ended at just after 4 a.m. with hundreds of Bob Marley and the Wailers fans still dancing inside the National Stadium, clamoring for more. I remember that night very well. So my girlfriend, Vonetta McGee, came to Jamaica now for the second film festival. And then she came for a special, it was a celebrity weekend, it was called. She actually came to play tennis. I don't know what somebody else was doing, but Stevie Wonder came and he was to perform. When we'd been in LA, Vonetta had introduced me to Stevie. She took me to a nightclub one night and Stevie was there and she said, "Hey, Stevie, meet my friend Barbara from Jamaica." And I said, "Yes, how do you do?" I know he didn't see me. He said, Hey, I'm doing a concert in San Francisco in 2 days' time. You girls want to come?" We said, "Yes." He gave us first-class tickets, and we flew down to San Francisco and went backstage. And he said, "You remember my friend Barbara from Jamaica?" "Yes." This time he came to Jamaica, and I said, "You know what?" And I went up to him, and I said, "I'm your Vonetta's friend. Welcome to my country." He wouldn't let me go. He held on to my hand. He said, "What? How lovely. When are you born? Tell me all about yourself." That was Stevie. The concert was called the Wonder Dream Concert. It featured Bob as one of the opening acts along with Third World. Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes had been billed to appear, but they didn't. Interestingly, this was the last time that Bob performed with the original Wailers, Peter Tosh and Bully Wailer. Bob joined Stevie Wonder on stage for two songs, "I Shot the Sheriff" and "Superstition." And once again, I was right under the stage. I was right there. I could see them right there. That was so great. So my friendship with Bob continued. You know, I really was a personal friend. I remember going up there once and they were playing ping pong. There was a ping pong table on what's now the veranda. And they were playing ping pong. And they gave me a ping pong bat. And I tried, I played a little, but I wasn't good enough, you know. I think they were into ping pong at the time, and maybe they were looking for another for the mixed doubles, you know, him and Skill Cole, and me and a certain lady with whom he later had one of his children. I remember ping pong. And then I remember being in the studio when he and Rita were making "I'm a Black Survivor." And they were working on the lyrics, the lines, "Some people got hopes and dreams, some people got ways and means." And schemes was in there somewhere. They were trying to work out the lyrics. Anyhow, they'd given me a little stool to sit on, sort of back from the mixing board. And I was sitting there listening to them. And then Bob got up and he came and sat down beside the stool and fell asleep. And they continued working. And then Neville Garrett came over and spoke to me and said something that made Bob wake up. And he got up, stood up, and I never forget the feeling like a little lion had jumped out of my lap. A little lion jumped out of my lap. I really remember that. Anyhow, here I am still working at the office of the Prime Minister, before the Smile Jamaica concert. And Bob and a couple of men, Rasta men, came up to the gates and we got a message. I picked up the phone, "Hello, the gate is telling me Bob Marley's here with some men to see the culture minister." And I remember they kept him waiting for over an hour in the sun. That's how little they thought of Bob Marley as an artist. Over 1 hour in the sun before he was allowed to come in. And that's when he told them, "I want to do a concert. Can I have permission to do it at National Heroes Park?" And they said yes. And then they went away and brought forward the election date and made it be close, so close that it looked like the concert was promotion for the election. I remember waiting for the bus to go down to Heroes Park that afternoon. It was going to be an evening show, like 6 o'clock or 5 o'clock. And, you know, I take the bus, and I lived right by Lady Musgrave Road, so I'm standing on the side of the road waiting for the bus, and an entourage of cars drives past. It's Michael Manley going down to the concert, and then they came to a stop, and the last car, the policeman got out, he came to me, and he said, "Miss Blake, the Prime Minister says drive with us," and, oh, thank you. I got in the car, and we drove down. But when we got nearly there, they obviously in the front got a message saying Bob wasn't there yet. So the cars turned around and we went up to Jamaica House. And we sat there for a long while until finally night came. Finally, they got a message that Bob was on his way down from Strawberry Hill. Bob was coming. So we got back in the cars and we drove down to National Heroes Park. And I was able to literally go in the crowd of the Prime Minister's cars up onto the stage and watch Bob perform on that very historic night. I remember that well. Well, that was, of course, he had gotten shot the night before. That's the history that everyone knows and has been told. You know, we all, the night he was shot, the whole of Jamaica waited to find out if he was dead or not. We didn't know. But just that Bob performed, having gone through such a traumatic experience, was really heroic, was very brave, because the rumors of why he had been shot, you know, I don't have to repeat them. You all know all the stories that were told. So you couldn't blame him. He left the island and stayed away for 2 years. Finally, they managed to persuade Bob to come back to Jamaica. Group of brethren from his ghetto, Rasta men, bad men, all persuaded him to come back to Jamaica to do the peace concert in 1978. I remember that night so well. There was a full moon over Warwicker Hill, and Warwicker Hill really meant something to me because of my history. Warwicker Hill had been my school. I knew Warwicker Hill intimately. I'd even climbed up to the top of Warwicker Hill. It's flat on the top, you know. It's completely flat on the top. But it's a long walk up to the top. Bad men run away who were wanted by the police for no other reason than perhaps smoking ganja or selling ganja, knew the way up the hill. So at least one time I'd walked up to the top. Warwicker Hill, the moon was full over Warwicker Hill. And I remember Peter Tosh's performance. That was quite, made us all laugh. You know, all we ganja smokers, you know, all of us illegal. Yeah, how you mean? Look, listen to me. You people don't know what we lived in as ganja smokers, you know. Every day, everything, just doing that was something that could get you arrested and put in prison every day of your life. You lived on that until you were brave enough and bad enough to do it. You had to be brave and bad to do what is legal today. Good heavens. I mean, your father sat next to your father in many of the meetings, the discussions, the conferences that were held to change the Dangerous Drugs Act and make it okay for us to grow 5 plants for ourselves, to use the herb sacramentally. You know, come on. Jamaica became the example to the world for ganja legalization. And we had to smile and see other countries or states legalizing before us. We've got it, not as far as we want to, but we have it. We can grow it medically, scientifically, and what's the other one? Thank you, whatever. Thank you. But yeah, that night, Peter Tosh, his famous criticism of the system, he had his own version. I won't pronounce it, but you all know his version of the word. And then when Bob called Manley and Siaga up on the stage, that was a frightening moment. I was again right under the stage, and we were all afraid that one or both of them would be shot. That was really the fear that rippled through the audience that night. And there was Bob just standing there, holding their hands above his head, looking up, speaking directly to the Creator and asking for peace, asking for a miracle that these two men could be united in love, that all the hatred and the war could be put aside and a new day be born. Yeah, that was a very, very brave thing to do. Incredible. It didn't achieve much. Yeah, here we still are. Mick Jagger got a nice song with Peter Tosh out of it. In 1978, I started a job as the public relations officer for the city of Kingston, the KSAC. I had a really good idea, you know, to just upgrade the image of the city, because there are 18 departments and they serve us well. They don't do it great, but we're trying to upgrade. So I had first an idea that each department would produce a beauty queen and we would have a Miss KSAC contest. That went very well in the end, actually, really nice. And then we had a beautiful march, three marches, one from Halfway Tree, one from Tivoli side, one from East Kingston side, marching bands with, you know, drumettes and majorettes and floats behind a float parade, that's what it was, right down to the waterfront. And the third thing I recommended was that, oh, it was called the Clean City Cat Campaign. And we had t-shirts, presented the Prime Minister with one, trying to clean up the city, keep the city clean. And I recommended that we give the keys to the city to three Jamaicans, Kingstonians, Harry Belafonte, Ranny Williams, the beloved comedian who did such good work every Christmas with the children the KSAC patronized or took care of, and Bob Marley. So KSAC sent the recommendation up to the Office of the Prime Minister, Culture Minister, and the answer came back, yes, you can give Harry Belafonte, yes, you can give Ranny Williams, but you can only give Bob Marley if he cut off his locks and stopped smoking ganja. Well, I had gone to Bob in the beginning and said, hey, Bob, I'm recommending that they give you the keys to the city. Would you accept? And he had said, Babylon burn, you know, Barbara. I said, but please. All right, go on. I had to go back to him and tell him, I'm really sorry, but it's not going to happen. And he said, I didn't tell you, said Babylon for burn. He was, I remember he was sitting speaking with a journalist named Malika Lee Whitney. She had brought Manu Dibango, a famous African percussionist, to meet him. And then they did the interview, and then he went and played some football on the lawn. There were always friends around willing to kick ball with Bob. And then he sat down on the steps and took out the book of the Emperor's autobiography. He said to me, Barbara, you read this book yet? And I said, no, you know, I'm still learning. I hadn't read it. He said, if we read this book, you know, lots of wisdom in this book, if we read this book. Oh, great. I think we have, the minister's here. Oh, lovely. Oh, she's sat. Minister Grange, thank you very much for being here. Thank you so much for being here. I've explained to them that you're only here as my friend, you know. They want you to give an official statement, and I'm sure you'll greet the people. But that you didn't even give me the day off from work. Thank you so much for being here. Yes, saying greetings to her friends. Thank you so much. You honor me, Minister. You honor me. Thank you, ma'am. See the gentleman beside you? You've met him. Nice. So he said, if you read this book, you know, Barbara, if you read this book. I said, okay, I will do that. But I'm going to have to go now. I have a bus to catch at Halfway Tree. He called the man with the van and said to me, which part you want to go? I said, Red Hills. He said to him, carry her whichever part you want to go. Carry her whichever where she want to go. Carry her whichever where she want to go. It was the last words I heard from Bob. Bob's funeral, I didn't go. Neither did Peter Tosh. I had by then become good friends of Abuna Isaac, the Ethiopian Archbishop, and I knew a lot of what was going on. There was a lot of controversy between the church, the Orthodox Church, and 12 tribes of Israel. Both wanted the rights to conduct the funeral service, and how they worked it out. I think Miss Grange was involved at that time in the arrangements that were made at the stadium, because there was a big tussle about who. But for me, you know, watching it on TV, I could hear another of Bach's songs. See the hypocrites, them a galang day. Yeah, that was who had come to the funeral. All the people who had ignored Bob, who called him Dirty Rasta, who wouldn't give him the keys to the city. There they were, sitting there very piously, waiting, place full. I just looked at it and said, look at that, the biggest funeral ever in Jamaican history. One time somebody asked Bob, you know, are you rich? Do you have a lot of money? Bob said, money don't make you rich. I don't have that kind of riches. I have life forevermore. And he's gone in the flesh, but he is immortal with his music. Bob is still alive 40 years after that passing. But, yes. Bob never changed, ever. That's why it's sometimes amusing and always amazing to see how famous this ordinary man, our friend, became. He always was the same man, humble, funny, strong, warrior, thoughtful, spiritual, down to earth, never changed. I'm glad so much of him remains in film so that we can see what he was like. So my life after Bob died was kind of, boy, what can I do? So I wrote a book. I decided to write a book. It's called Joseph Arasta Reggae Fable. I'm going to show you some copies of it. This was the first edition. I don't know how I got it printed, but I gave it to Novelty Trading Company to distribute, and they were so pleased with it, they actually printed the second edition. And they said, Barbara, do it properly. Some illustrations would be nice. And I went and got a friend of mine to do illustrations throughout the book. And this edition sold really well, so well that Novelty recommended the book to Macmillan to be published. I approved a cover for the book, but when they sent me a copy of the actual book, it was nothing like the one I had approved. And I had to endure while they distributed that. It sold very badly. And when finally that contract ended, I was able to put the cover I had approved on the book. That's this one. I didn't put any illustrations in. But, and in the meantime, oops. Serbia thinks so highly of Bob Marley that they took that book and translated it into Serbian, and it's distributed, yeah. So looking at all of that and thinking about this lecture, I decided, you know what, why you don't make another edition and put the illustrations in it? And I did. So this is the new book. I want to tell you, see how the cover is pretty? Yes. See that gentleman over there trying to be shy? He did the cover. Yes, yes. Joe Jorgensen is a lifelong Wailers and reggae fan, lover, and collector. Within his collection of Wailers memorabilia, Joe has amassed an almost complete library, or rather, a truthbury of Bob, over 400 Marley books. Good word, yes. He wrote, most Bob Marley books fit into one of the standard categories, such as biographies, photography, or songbooks. But fortunately, one in particular that creates its own category is Joseph, a Rasta Reggae Fable. As the title suggests, it's a fable about Joseph, a fictional reggae musician from the third world who rises up to worldwide fame only to ride off into the African sunset. Sounds somewhat familiar? After my first read, it instantly became one of my favorites. For those that know the Bob Marley story, the fable will flow right along, but Barbara will always throw in a few surprises for you. It's a happy ending, and one I wish could have been reality. Why did I write it? A lot of people have written Marley biographies and assessments of his work, but I haven't read any that show the Rasta side of Bob. They can show lots of red, gold, and green icons, Bob's photos, performances, and interviews, but they can't explain what it was that made this Rasta man so enormously successful. Dylan and Springsteen have had hits and become famous, but none have overtaken the world as this dreadlocks black Rasta man. Only a Rasta can explain it. Who feels it knows it. The Rasta side of Bob is the secret of Bob's success. When you're a Rasta, you know how the knowledge gives you access to great powers, great spiritual awareness, and out of that, great success. People outside Rasta can only look on and marvel, but it's necessary to come within to fully understand Rasta. That's why I came within. So I decided to write a book about Bob from inside a Rasta mind. Each chapter begins with a Bible verse, not just to refer to what is coming and what inspired the chapter, but to bless it and to make sure I kept the fullness of Rastafari within it. The two women in the book are the two sides of me. One, the black English woman who worked for Blackwell. The other is the Rasta woman who was a friend and lived Rasta life. I also wrote it because I wish Bob's life had gone more like my story. My book is what could have been, what should have been, that he didn't die. We all wish. It hasn't become a bestseller yet, but it's fed us a few times. So there are four editions and now the new illustrated gold medal edition. It's online at Amazon if any of you are interested. Let me give you a review of the book by S.M. Robinson. I didn't want the story of the legendary reggae artist Joseph to end, and even though I knew it was loosely based on the life of Bob Marley and that the inevitable outcome was not going to be favorable, I still turned each and every page with anticipation that his fate wouldn't be as disappointing, gone too soon. From the opening of the novel, The Funeral of the Fictional Rastafarian Reggae Superstar Joseph, the reader is introduced to just how significant this moment in Jamaican history is. His death is a loss to the music industry and to the Jamaican community. His presence was necessary and unfortunately lost. Through her character, Joseph, his associates and peers, Barbara Makeda Blake Hanna takes us on a spiritual and musical expedition as spectators to the historical milestones in his life. From the first moments of the novel, we're taken back to 1970s Jamaica, the political and social climate, and the circumstances that inspired Joseph's music. Although the book itself was written in 1992, it vividly presents a time that many of us have heard about and seen in archives, but never had the pleasure of truly experiencing. What I love most about the book is that the spiritual journey was evident and displayed in the characters' actions and words. The dialect was personal as well as informational, as Joseph and his peers explained and defended the foundations of their Rastafari beliefs through interviews, conversations, and their regular reasonings. So I started trying to live as an author. I mean, I'd rejected the system as much as I could. So I went to live in New York to try and get it published there. I stayed at the church and enjoyed being at the church. The Archbishop was then in New York. Didn't get it published. I moved to Los Angeles to visit Vonnetta, thinking, well, LA is the place to be. Not much was happening. I remember waking up one morning in her beautiful, she had a lovely house, and then she had a guest house that I stayed in. And it was cold, and I looked up through the window, and a little bird came and sat on a branch, a nice little bird. And another little bird came and joined it. Oh, that's cute, he's got a partner. And then a third little bird came, and I said, whoa, don't you worry about a thing, because every little thing's gonna be all right. Yeah, woke up this morning. You remember that song? Of course. I said, get up here, Barbara. That's a sign I just sent you, three little birds. Bob Marley speaking to you. Go down in the town, you'll find a bookshop that wants to buy your books. And I did. I got some sales, I got some money. I also got a friend who gave me a ticket back to Jamaica. In 1974, I was invited to be a senator, an independent senator. That's where I met this friend of mine you see sitting in the front row, Miss Olivia Grange. That's where we became friends in 1984. Yes, just friends. She sat on that side, I sat on this side. And my first debate was that Marcus Garvey's birthday should be a national holiday. And the president of the Senate liberated all the senators to debate as they wished. They could take any side. And I remember John Issa, who was a government senator, taking my side and saying, yes, he agreed, and he liked what Marcus Garvey had to say, because too many of his Syrian relatives wanted to change the shape of their noses, and he didn't approve of that. You know, he liked the racism of Garvey, the pride in his African heritage. Miss Grange was very polite. The government said we couldn't afford another national holiday, but the government would make a national holiday for the parish of St. Anne, where Marcus Garvey was born, and they did, and it was a wonderful day. So with compromise, we continued. They said it was the best Senate ever in Jamaican history. The New York Times said it was the best Senate in Jamaican history, because it was the first time there were truly independent voices, not tied to the political fight. And we tried to be independent. I was pregnant then. Yes. I gave birth to my baby in the Senate, not in the Senate, while I was a senator. In fact, the Prime Minister, Mr. Siaga, called me and three other Rastas, Rita Marley, Sam Clayton, and myself. We were the three Rastas. And his senator, Miss Grange. And the four of us sat with him at the office of the Prime Minister when he announced there was going to be a special day of fundraising for Ethiopian famine. And my particular job was to go to the radio station and accept the radio call-ins. And I was 7 months pregnant. I remember having to take the calls, run up to the studio, run back down, take the calls, run up to the studio, run back down. By the end of the day when I came home, Makone had started coming into the world at 7 months. It was not an easy time. It wasn't. I was also, the minister had taken pity on the fact that I had no employment whatsoever, and she'd actually given me a job. She was running a World Festival of Youth and Students, and she asked me to organize a youth film festival during that, and I did. I brought some youth films, and that was actually my job. I remember feeding Makone and running to the National Arena, the National Stadium, to tell them what this film, the next film that's coming, and then running back to the house, feeding Makone and coming back. Yeah, but he lived, I'm glad to say. He lived. But when that was over, you know, politics took over again. I couldn't get a job, you know, the other side felt all those who had agreed, the eight of us who had agreed to be senators, they didn't like us, because if we had said no, they would have had to call another election. And we had said yes. And so, I mean, I know you know the politics. What had happened was the Prime Minister called an election. The opposition party said they wouldn't contest because the list was not complete. They So the Prime Minister said, well, I'll go ahead and call and run the election anyway, and he did. So there were 60 seats, and all 60 seats were won by his party. That was fine for the lower house, but in the upper house, there was no one to appoint the opposition senators. So they consulted the Constitution. The Constitution said it's actually the Governor General who appoints all the senators. So a recommendation was made for 8 independent senators. I was the only woman and the only Rasta. I'm still the only Rasta to have sat in Parliament, although I see a lot of people with dreadlocks. Who knows? Maybe. Anyway, officially, Miss Grange, confirm it for me when you can, please. Thank you, darling. So, I spent 12 years in the poverty wilderness, being a Rasta mother. I homeschooled my son so I could raise him as a Rasta. I took him to the top, you know, prep school, and they were so amazed that he could read. He was 4 and he could read. But you will cut his hair, won't you, Mrs. Anna? I said, no. So I went, I homeschooled him. Sometimes, thank you, darling. Thank you, Sister Aisha. Sometimes a friend gave us shelter. Sometimes a job gave me a luxury hotel room. But I remember best the tent at Deborah's Eat on the hillside by the river. Cold ground was my bed last night, and rock stone my pillow too. And when it rained, Bob said, no woman, no cry. Yeah, no woman, no cry. So I didn't cry. I raised my son out of all that to have him declared a genius at 13. Thank you, Ja. Thank you very much, Ja. So what about reggae survival after Bob? Is it the end of Rasta reggae days? It was a big surprise to see reggae's popularity being overtaken by dancehall immediately after Bob died. Some say it was a deliberate plot by international politics to destroy the Rasta philosophy that seemed to have given Jamaica a new way of viewing the world. Fans of Yellow Man and Shabaranks would disagree. Let it be the development of the music. At this stage, the Jamaican headliners of Bob's Rasta Reggae 70s are almost a nostalgia thing. Those who remain with us are rare performers on Jamaican stages these days, more easily seen on the foreign concert stages in Europe and America. The memories of the great days of reggae sunsplash are buried under the dancehall dons and divas of reggae sunfest. Sunsplash has become sunfest, and reggae is about money today, not Rasta. Bless you, Tony Rebel, for trying to keep it alive. Has reggae recovered from Bob's passing? Of course it has. The survivors keep the fire burning. Burning Spear, Culture, Freddie McGregor, Big Youth, Kid Asai, Third World, Chalice, Chinna Smith, Steel Pulse, Buju Banton, Luciana, Max Romeo, Coco T, Sizzla, Kalonji. I could keep naming names. I saw a white dreadlocks reggae band performing at Rototom. I was shocked to hear exactly the same music, same instruments, same rhythms as familiar reggae songs. Just the lyrics changed up a little to exclude praising Africa, also not sung in English. They copy Jamaica's roots Rasta reggae. They make up their own lyrics these days, and they play on reggae shows in place of Jamaican Rasta reggae artists. I know they're trying their best to be part of the movement, but they will never understand. Who feels it knows it. Most of the new music coming out of Jamaica today is not roots Rasta reggae anymore, but some strong youths keep the Rasta flame alive. Chronix, Kabaka Pyramid, Jesse Royal, Micah Shemaya, Esau, even Space Age Rasta. Did we kill the goose that laid the golden egg? Jamaica Observer front page. Reggae eruption in Europe, waning audiences, exorbitant artist fees, competition from other genres threaten Jamaican music. My friend David Williams wrote on his Facebook page, I saw this coming long time. Hype plus ignorance spells gloom and doom for the king's music. Certain dunce hall artists charging three times the normal race, Europe turning their eyes to other genres. But reggae is still here, reminding us of slavery as we seek reparations. We remember their music in our campaign for reparations. Bob Marley's album Exodus, Time Magazine album of the century. When we see Sedella Booker, Bob's mother, who was 16 years old, when Bob's father, Norval Marley, who was 60 years old, gave her a child and left her to find her own way to raise Bob. We see the slave plantations where this kind of union between black and white was the way things were, whether the black woman liked it or not. Bonnie Wailer was asked if Bob, being mixed, was teased. More like rejected, he said, teased as a half-breed, outsider. But Emperor Haile Selassie is Bob's real father. Haile Selassie is the chapel, power of the Trinity. Build your mind on this direction. Serve the living God and live. Yes, Jah. Haile Selassie set Bob free to be the unique soul, the singing angel that he became and still is. Bob's image has taken many forms in this new age. Lover, millionaire. I know Bob would love us to remember him as the revolutionary, as the Rasta pioneer for black reparation to Africa. Exodus is Bob's background music for the repatriation campaign. Bob was a revolutionary while he was here. Everything he did while he lived was revolutionary. He was a Steve Biko, a Malcolm X, a Huey Newton. I came home in 1972 as a black revolutionary. Angela Davis was my heroine and example. Jamaica had Fidel Castro as their revolutionary. Bob was the real revolutionary, the Rasta revolutionary. We must remember Bob's revolutionary songs like Johnny Was a Good Boy, Curfew, 3 o'clock Roadblock, Small Axe. Small Axe is one of the most revolutionary songs to ever come out of reggae. Nowadays you only hear One Love and No Woman No Cry and Turn Your Lights Down Low. Don't forget Bob the Rasta revolutionary. Bob must also be remembered as a teacher of the Rastafari faith. Bob was the man who asked black and white to love one another because he was both black and white. A good message. We will never forget the strength of the Rasta message he brought to the world, one love. Bob's biggest message is the message of the Christ, love. The world sings it, even if we don't live it. I like what I see the family and the foundation doing to keep the things that Bob believed in, was passionate about, his message alive, living the Rastafari creed. As Rasta, we must always live the Rastafari creed, that the hungry be fed, the naked clothed, the sick nourished, the aged protected, and the infants cared for. Rita and the family are doing a good job. Yes, my little sister. Remember, Bob said, my life is for people, that I can be beneficial to people. We have Bob's music. We love Bob's music. We've been singing Hungry Belly Children to sleep with it for a long time. Every little thing's gonna be all right. So let me just list Bob's musical achievements. Bob successfully transcended three Jamaican musical genres from the 1960s through to the early 1980s, ska, rocksteady, and reggae, his most influential musical form. And after almost three decades since his death, his music is still relevant to millions of people across the globe. The story is not over. We all see how much bigger Bob has become in the 42 years after his death. Bob has become more than a man. He is a symbol of Rasta culture, of reggae music, of an era. Bob didn't make Rasta, but Bob made Rasta greater than it had been. Bob made Rasta world famous. Many say Bob is worthy to be Jamaica's next national hero. I believe Bob should be Jamaica's next national hero. So to finish, I'm going to tell you three little stories. Bob is kind of, I don't care what you all say, Bob is a guardian angel of mine. Bob is a very special kind of man. Bob, there's three miracles I associate with Bob. The first is the power cut. Every year in the early days after Bob dies, the 56 Hope Road, the family would always hold a celebration up at 56 Road, up Hope Road. I think they stopped because the crowd was just huge. On this particular night, the crowd filled up the whole place, and there was music, and there was food, and there was drink. Everybody was enjoying themselves. I remember I was upstairs in the little room that overlooks the field. Miss Grange was up there. Chris Blackwell was there, Rita. And everybody enjoying themselves, and suddenly, bow, power cut. So in the silence now, the Rasta men who are there, the drummers, start to drum and play some Nyabingi. And we who are Rasta, we could sing along, the few of us who are there, and we're singing along. Singing. But everybody is just, you know, still there waiting for the power to come back on until they get to the song. So let the words of my mouth and the meditation, you hear, everybody starts singing, be acceptable in thy sight, oh, for I, the power came right back on. Boom, just like that, just like that. Everybody said, oh, miracle number one. Miracle number two, so another night, birthday night, we're up there, and you know, we're all there out on the lawn, and they're about to cut the cake. The Orthodox Church has just done prayers, and the Nyabingi have sung their songs. And they're about to cut the cake. The knife is in the cake when somebody screamed and said, look, it had been a full moon. And as usual, a full moon, there had been a gold circle around the moon. But when we looked up, it was a red, gold, and green circle around the moon. And if you think I'm lying, it was on the front page of the Gleaner the next day that people in Jamaica, the moon, had a red, gold, and green circle around it. Were you there that night? I was there that night. I saw it. Many did. Front page of the Gleaner. And the third miracle. So I'm around at 56 Hope Road. Go there all the time. It's the oasis, you know. You can have a rest. You might even get a spliff, you know what I mean? By them time, the Viva was making juices. And I'm walking around, going around to the front, and I look up, and on the Bombay mango tree, there's the most beautiful Bombay mango. Beautiful, just out of my reach, I can't reach it. I say, what a shame, because it's gonna drop, you know, it's gonna split, it's gonna get soft. What a shame, all right. I go around, I do my business, and I'm coming back around, and right in front of me on the ground is the Bombay mango. It's not split, and it's not soft. I just said, thank you, Bob. Legends aren't born. They are made by the lives they live. One love, Bob Marley. Legend.
Wow. Wow.
Thank you all so much. Thank you all so much.
Uh-huh. Yes, 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 absolutely. There is certainly a place for nostalgia, certainly a place for memory. And the room was transfixed as everybody, there were probably people who would have lived some of the times that Empress Hannah would have spoken about. And there would have been memories that would have been circulating in our own minds. I was a little girl. But it's funny. I think the interview that you spoke about was actually an interview done by my mother of Bob Marley. The words that you said actually sound very familiar, because it was one of the it's one of the only interviews of a Jamaican journalist that can be found outside of probably the Institute of Jamaica of Bob Marley. So that triggered, you know, nostalgia and memory. Remarkable. Thank you very much. We're going to be asking some questions. Thank you. But before we do that, Miss Sarah is not available. So I'd like to welcome Honorable Babsy Grange to just say a word.
Greetings, everyone. I'm here because of my friend Barbara. And while I'm on the way, Barbara called me and told me that I was down to do greetings. I don't know how I got on the program. I don't know if I should blame Barbara or Deborah. So I am, yes, I'm now Deborah's aunt. I mean, we're on opposite sides, but I'm still her aunt. And she's now my shadow. But just to, first I just want to acknowledge my sister Barbara, Dr. Goss, Stephanie, you good? Good. She's also, I'm her auntie, right? And Dennis, good seeing you. And Laldi, still Laldi. And all my other friends here, because most persons here, Professor Vereen Shepherd, Carolyn Cooper, who me boss are in the music business, right? Me boss are, right? Because when I was managing Shabarangs and others, I was doing a seminar and I asked her to come and speak, and she wrote this wonderful poem and mash up the place. And from that, she has been just that voice and just mashing up the place. But I just want to say that now David Brown, who is here, who is our director of research, policy and research. David, where are you? David hiding. All right. When he heard I was coming, he prepared some notes for me. Right? But I don't think I'm going to use the notes. I'm going to just say a few things about Barbara and a couple of my interaction and experience with Bob. Maxine, greetings. Now, Barbara, while I was in the Senate, when Mr. Siaga decided to appoint Barbara a senator, I really was a bit surprised, I must confess. So I said to him, Mr. Siaga, why did you appoint Barbara a senator? Mr. Siaga didn't even know Barbara. He said, Barbara represents the Jamaican woman. That's why I'm doing it. She's poor. She take bus. She speaks her mind. And she's a Rasta woman. Mr. Siaga never met Barbara. So he decided he would appoint her a senator. Well, of course, in those days, they don't appoint a senator. A Rasta woman to be a Rasta, much more a Rasta woman. But we ended up becoming good friends in the Senate because from those days, I was the junior minister for culture. And I was like Mr. Siaga's right-hand person. And so, and I think I may have been deputy leader of the Senate at that time. And when it was decided, this was Marcus Garvey's centenary, because we celebrated the centenary of our heroes. So Garvey's centenary was quite a big thing. But this issue about the holiday, and Mr. Siaga says, I'd love to do it, but there are too many holidays, there are issues with the union, and so on. And so Barbara proposed, we argued, I can tell you. I'm on one side and she's on the other side. And we were both very, very strident. I had to take the position that we can't have a national holiday because of the issues there. And Barbara says, you must have a national holiday. So we eventually compromised. I went home, I thought about it, I spoke to Mr. Siaga. I said, can we do a national holiday in the parish? And he said, yes. When we left the Senate, I think we lost the elections, and I got into the music business. Officially, I got into the music business because I was involved in music. I grew up in West Kingston. And around me was music, the church, the bar, revival. So I was exposed to everything. Up the road was Duke Reed Studio. And I was a part of all of that mix. So I decided, no, going into the music business. And Barbara, no, before that, in fact, I hired Barbara to work with me in the office of the Prime Minister. Remember that, Barbara? And I'm trying to remember if you were there when Bob passed.
I was not working with Bob.
Okay. But we did a lot of great things together. She did the film festival, which was a part of, we did 45 events in 10 days to when the International Year of the Youth was introduced. And I was responsible to do the cultural side, and we invited young people from all over the world. And we did film festival, jazz festival, anything you can think of, gospel. The Hawkins sister, the Hawkins group came to Jamaica. Mtumbe, for those who are old enough to know, and so on. And Barbara did the film festival. And we brought the conceptualizer and organizer of the Toronto Film Festival to Jamaica. And I also brought a friend of mine from Toronto, Calvin Butler, and said to him, I want you to, Oliver Samuels was working at the SDC at the time as a community officer. But Oliver was so funny. I borrowed him from the SDC. I said to Calvin, we're going to use Oliver to do all the commercials for all the events. And when we're finished, we're going to tape a comedy series. I want us to do a comedy series. And at the end of it all, we didn't have the money to do the comedy series, but we did 5-minute vignettes. And that's how Oliver at Large was born. But Barbara was always this genuine individual. Man, you know. Barbara, when she hold a point and she hold a position, trust me. And we had, at times, opposite, but we always eventually come to an understanding and work it out. But I always felt personally responsible for Barbara. we developed that bond. That and Barbara sometimes, you know, Barbara used to write speeches for me at times, and we had a little difference. And Barbara writing the paper, the newspaper, that is, she write my speech. Yeah. Oh, I wrote this for her, but in spite of that, I just had this feeling we had this great relationship. Conan grew up when I was in the music business. I said to Barbara, come to my office. We set a liquor corner for Conan as a kid, and she would nurse him in the office, and we'd carry on doing our business. And so Conan grew up in my arms. So I just want to say that Barbara has been blamed many times to be associated with me as someone in politics. That's the community. Sometimes, Sister Mitzi, at times they feel that Barbara is politically tainted, but I can assure everyone, she has her own views. She's a real Rasta woman. The first and the only Rasta to serve in Parliament, as she said. You know, there are people who are dread and there are people, but Barbara is an empress. She is a real Rasta woman. And that is why she's also very important to me, because she is a cultural liaison in the ministry. And you know, government tend to, after a certain age, they don't want to employ you. But every time our contract is to be renewed, I go and I fight for it, because she is a legend. She is a legend. She has so much information in her head, and she writes a lot. But she could, didn't you find her presentation very interesting and very informative? So I'm really happy she was invited to do this lecture. Most appropriate. Watch, I'm gonna finish. You give a politician a mic and they don't stop. But I'm just gonna indicate Joseph, the book that Barbara wrote. We actually have a film, a screenplay written, because we were discussing doing a film of Joseph. We even came up with the music list for the film. And it's something we still want to do. We still want to do it. There could be a little sensitivity, Stephanie, because it's you read the story and you see Bob in it. But now that the movie is out, right? It's time for Joseph. And so with those few words, I want to thank you, whoever is responsible for putting me on the program. And just to say, I think I participated once. I did a lecture here during Reggae Month some time ago. But I'm still available if you wish to invite me again. God bless you all, and thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to very quickly take a few questions. We're going to ask you to hold on comments, but to ask very specific questions, if there are any. And in asking the questions, you can give one to Barbara. She doesn't necessarily need to come back up. Let us try to keep the commentary ahead of the questions to a minimum. You want to give a mic to Empress Hannah, Sister Barbara? Is there anybody who has a question?
Oh, questions. Yes, does anybody really want to ask questions? What could I possibly say? on? Yes, I'll answer on this one.
Blessings. You don't know? We'll go too far. My question, know the your book, Joseph, you say 1992. Yes. Did it have anything to do with the centenary of His Majesty's Earth Strong, July 1992, 100 years since Christ came forward on earth in the flesh? And I and I were in Ethiopia for the centenary and to bring back and forward the Ethiopians forward to Ethiopia. Did it have anything to do with that during that year?
I didn't intend it, but you've given me some interesting information. It shows that it happened at that time for that reason. You see, these are the miracles. We don't even know when they happen. We think miracle is just a foolish word you read of in this book called the Bible. But miracles are real. Because you show me that that's when the inspiration was given to me. You know, you see these 10 points? I don't write, you know. Words come to me and they come out through these 10 points. And I don't know what I've written. That's why Miss Green said I wrote something and said that I wrote her speech. I don't even remember doing that. Sometimes I look at what I've written and I say, Barbara, you really wrote that? Oh, boy. I have to reread. So you're showing me that that happened. You show me why that book came out then. And that's even more important. It's even more important. That Joseph must be made into a film. But I want you all to read the book, you know. I want you all to read the book. It's not expensive. It's $25 online. That's nothing. That's nothing for a book. You want me to drop the price down some more just so you read it? Write and tell me. No, seriously. That's enough, is it, please? Yes.
We'll
another
take
question.
We'll take another?
Yes.
Yeah. We'll take two more, and then we're going to wrap up. Stephen?
Yes.
Two questions in one. I know you were awarded by the Ethiopian royal family. You didn't tell us anything about that, if you could say a little about that. And secondly, do you know of the connection between Bob and the royal family while he was living in the UK?
Yes. Yes, I'm very proud to be wearing my two Ethiopian medals. In 1997, Prince Hermes, the grandson of Emperor Haile Selassie and Archbishop Isaac of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, awarded me this gold medal. It's the 100th anniversary of the Battle of Adwa. On the reverse of the Ethiopian lion is Emperor Menelik for services to the Orthodox Church. It was the prince's first visit to Jamaica, and I helped organize his itinerary and his travels around Jamaica, and they gave me this gold medal. Last year, Minister Grange was awarded she was made a dame of the Order of Ethiopia, Order of the Star of Ethiopia. She has a huge golden star and a sash she wears across her. And that was thanks from the grandson, the chairman of the Ethiopian Council, Prince Hermes, for the visit to Jamaica that Minister Grange arranged last year in National Heroes Week. I was her assistant on that project. And they were kind enough to award me the Order of Officer of the Star of Ethiopia. And this is my star. Hers is so big, she don't get to wear it every day like I get to wear mine. So this is mine. These are my two Ethiopian medals. All I'll say is my Order of Distinction fell. Someone stepped on it, and I can't pin it on. I need a new one, Miss Green. This is my bigger one, please. This is my Ethiopian Orthodox cross. All Ethiopians wear their crosses around their necks. The word is maskil. This is my maskil, and I have a nice one. Makonnen has two. Oh, one is a medal. I'm sorry. Oh, you just have your maskil. Okay. And right. The second question now you asked, I'm very fortunate that about 3 weeks ago, we had two very important visitors to Jamaica. Who helped run a house in Bath, England called Fairfield House. Fairfield House is a house that was purchased by the emperor when he lived in England. He fled to England in exile when he tried and failed to defeat the Italians who had invaded and waged a terrible war to colonize Ethiopia. They managed to live there for 4 years, carrying out the most awful, terrible actions against the Ethiopian people. The emperor had a choice to stay and be killed, as all so many people, so many races, leaders, bright young people who could have helped improve Ethiopia were massacred in the most awful way. He had a choice to stay and be massacred or to go to Europe and try and get help to overthrow the Italians, and he did that. He went to England. He stayed at first in hotels, but then he realized his stay was going to be long, and he bought a house at Fairfield House in Bath, England. Lived there for 4 years. It was sad. I'm reading the book now, and it's really sad to read the story. But when he finally managed to get help, British army came to his rescue. They went to Ethiopia, overthrew the Italians, and he was able to return. He gave the house to the people of Bath as an old people's home, and it still is. However, the Rastafari community in Britain have adopted Fairfield House as their own, because the emperor, it's like the emperor's spirit is still there, and they help maintain it. We keep ceremonies there, special events, the library, we upkeep the house. Fairfield House is our remnants of the Ethiopia in England. For me, it's one place in England. It's the only reason I would ever go back to England, and that would be to visit Fairfield House. The emperor prayed there every day. He had his priests brought over from Ethiopia to pray with him there. He made a special chapel at the house. And the angels he prayed to, their spirits are still there. And I feel if I could go and pray there, anything I prayed for, I would receive. That's how important Fairfield House is to us. And it was lovely to meet the two visitors from Fairfield House last week. Stephen was one of those who had the pleasure. Thanks for allowing me to mention Fairfield House and our beloved emperor.
Deborah, I just wanted to ask Barbara.
Yes, ma'am.
You may want to indicate the visit to Jamaica, how important a role it played in establishing a better relationship with the government of Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Prince Hermes being invited. So you may want to, because that was very important. And I think that was why I was shown his appreciation by being awarded.
Yes, indeed.
It wasn't just because I was minister, right? I think.
No,
my cross, which I got after the Bob Marley
funeral,
because of how I
Yes, the Archbishop, after Bob Marley's funeral, gave her a gold mascot, a gold Lalibela cross. It's very rare and very precious, and I wish it was mine. No, let me just say what she asked me. Let me answer her question. It was the third time Prince Hermes has visited Jamaica. As I said, he came in 97 when he gave me this medal. The Rastafari community invited him in, Aisha would tell me the exact year, but the Rastafari community invited him, and they had a special itinerary for him. He was here. But this visit was very important for Prince Hermes. To be recognized by the government of Jamaica caused the government of Ethiopia to really see the relationship between Jamaica and Ethiopia more clearly. It wasn't just, you know, a man and a so-called descendant of a former emperor, but here was the Jamaica, a very well-respected country, recognizing Prince Hermes as a representative of Ethiopia, and immediately on the very last day of his visit, they invited him, and he received an invitation to visit Ethiopia from the prime minister, and also to be present at a presentation at the Organization of African Unity. And that was very important. While he was here, Prince Hermes and Minister Grange signed a memorandum of understanding between Jamaica and the Crown Council And one of the terms of that memorandum of understanding is that there will be a statue of the emperor erected in Jamaica. It's being, the maquette is being designed right now by our leading sculptor, Barry Watson, who did the Usain Bolt, Basil Watson. He did the Usain Bolt statue. He did the Windrush statue in London. And that would be erected in Jamaica. And that's very important because, you know, we've had pictures, we've had statues to English kings and queens, but never an Ethiopian monarch. And we think that's due. Jamaica respects and loves Ethiopia. We know Ethiopia as the proper name of Africa. The proper name of Africa was Ethiopia long ago. Ethiopia is our jumping off point into Africa. Some want to live in Ghana, some Nigeria, etc. But Ethiopia is our home. Ethiopia is where Rastafari have set up land in Shashamani. The emperor gave us land in Shashamani. They've set up residence in Ethiopia. And no matter what, we'll always maintain that. And the ability to maintain those links with Ethiopia was reconfirmed with that visit to Jamaica at that important time. Say that again? It's the second visit? Thank you, 2022. Thank you very much. That was the Rastafari visit to Jamaica. And that was very important. But, I mean, Ethiopia just said, oh, those Rastas who like, you know, Selassie. But when the government of Jamaica does that, I mean, his first stop was to pay courtesy call on the Governor General. His second stop was to meet the Prime Minister, who wasn't there. He met the Deputy Prime Minister. And his third stop was the Houses of Parliament, to meet the President of the Senate and the Speaker of the House. And those are the three most important points of our Constitution. Those are the tip of our crown. The Prime Minister, the Governor General, the Prime Minister, and the Houses of Parliament. So that looks good to the world, and Ethiopia respected it, and we respect it. So as she says, you know, giving her that beautiful award, she has the right to be called Dame Olivia Grange, you know. She was given that right, yes. Like, Dame is the female of a knight. Like you would have Sir Aunt Harold Wilson and Dame Margaret Thatcher. She's Dame Olivia Grange, but we just call her Babsy.
He had to sign the guest book. And they found a page where His Imperial Majesty signed when he visited Jamaica.
Yes.
And had him sign opposite that page. Yes. And he was moved to tears.
That's history. That's beautiful history.
It was quite a very significant and memorable occasion.
Yes.
He was moved to tears.
Yeah. We make no apology for loving Ethiopia. We make no apology for making Ethiopia
I'm giving
the
it
most
to her.
Important
I have
country
to say
in
this. Give thanks. Beloved, it just, as you say, you know, it's just mystic, okay? 1992 was my first ambassadorial assignment as the Queen Mother of the Rastafari faith, you know? Yes. And it just so happened that just as I was coming to Jamaica, this dropped into my bag and I brought it. It says, power legacy of the visit. The legacy of Emperor Haile Selassie's visit to Jamaica, 21st of April, 1966, with respect to the impact to the Rastafarians and the movement, examined from political, cultural, social, and economic points of view. No other state leader's visit has captured the triumph of human spirit as Emperor Haile Selassie's memorable visit to Jamaica. Jamaica received the emperor as the second coming of Christ. This was not a part of the government's reception schedule. It came to pass on the script of the Rastafarians, who snatched away the role of host from the government in a welcoming ceremony at Palisades Airport in Kingston. Mortimer Planner, Wulde Harriet, one of the Rastafarian leaders, was the first person to enter into the airplane to shake hands with the emperor. Planner accompanied the emperor through the huge crowd of Rastafarians. Official protocol was disregarded and implemented in Rastafarian-style government.
Thank you so much. No, thank you. I think that she's calling crows, you know.
Yeah, I just wanted to, I know I didn't get a chance to speak, but I came all the way from Gambia, West Africa, and I haven't been in Jamaica in a while. I love you so much. You've been my mentor. We've lived together. I've learned a lot from you. There's something that you said, for those that don't know me, my name is Oli Matatau. I'm an international publicist. And two publicists that I really look up to are here today, and that's Honorable Mama Barbara Blake, Hannah, and also Clive Davis. I mean, help me out.
Ask your question.
My question here is, you mentioned something about there's a reason why reggae music has declined financially throughout the world. And as a publicist, I felt like there's been a large attack by the LGBTQ movement. Do you think that that has had a major impact in really having an economic decline on reggae music with the cancellation of tours and the attack by that movement against the reggae artists of Jamaica?
What was your question? Do I think that?
Targeting the LGBTQ, targeting reggae, if it had a negative impact.
Please, leave that. I think we ended well on what Empress had to say.
Well, I know that Miss Cadian, our head cook and bottle washer, no, but seriously, I'd like everybody please to put their hands together for Cadian Williams and Bettine Ross-Laws, who are the absolute backbone of the Institute of Caribbean Studies, who have put all the elements together. Cadian, you're going to make a presentation? No? Okay. All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you know what they say about time. That time has come. It's time for us now to invite Sister Barbara to receive a token of our appreciation from Dr. Dave Goss, who is the head of department of the Institute of Caribbean Studies, on the occasion of the 27th annual Bob Marley Lecture. It was a wonderful, wonderful evening. It was a remarkable evening, which reminded me of the importance, as we take the photographs and we close things out, of being in the middle of history. And and Barbara certainly Sister Barbara certainly took us back into the middle of history. I also want to end by thanking Stephanie Marley for her call to action this evening, as she calls upon us all to stand up and to move out of the shadows and to have our voices heard. It's an important time. It's what Bob would have wanted, and the time is now ripe for that. Thank you all for coming. Have a good evening.
And before you go, we end tomorrow our 8th Global Reggae Conference. So we'll be here all day tomorrow. So please join us as we continue the deliberation in our reggae and global reggae conference. Thank you very much, everybody. God bless you. One love.
They made their